You're listening to the Deep Purple Podcast, a fan podcast about one of the most legendary bands of all time, Deep Purple. We take a look at the music, history, and people behind the band Deep Purple and beyond.
Welcome to the Deep Purple Podcast, the first and only podcast devoted to one of the greatest bands in rock history, Deep Purple. Today's episode is episode number 198, Deep Purple, live with Joe Satriani, Saarbrücken, 1994, part two. Oh my goodness. And coming to you from the flaking and dying hand suburbs of Chicago, I'm your host, Nathan Beaudry.
And coming to you from the suburbs of Providence, I'm your co-host, John Golfer's Elbow Matola.
Oh, no. Really?
Oh, yeah.
Well, I got tennis elbow, and I'm like a couple, two years ago, maybe? And I'm assuming it had as much to do with tennis as yours does with golf?
Well, except for, like, you know, when I'm making jokes, and then in my physical comedy, I go, hey-o, and then I do a fake golf swing like Johnny Carson.
So that's how you got it?
Yeah, so the doc told me I had to cut back on the physical comedy, the shtick, you know.
He's like, hey, I've been watching your show. It is a laugh a minute. You got to dial it back a little.
So I have, like, you know, for those that don't know, which most of our listeners probably do know, tennis elbow is on the outside. Golfers have elbows on the inside, so it really hurts. Yeah. Where it's really tender. So I was shopping for a brace, a compression brace to wear around my forearm. Mm-hmm. Because I read that, you know, in addition to stretching and resting it and everything, if you have to lift, like, either, you know, at work, I have to lift things or, you know, weights or whatever, the compression brace will put even pressure on all of the tendons and make it, you know, promote healing and, you know, let it, you know, make it easier to, you know, do your activities. So of course I'm searching on Amazon, and I found a really great one, actually. And so of course, right to the reviews, and this will be a short one, which was my favorite. Customer review: don't buy it.
That's to the point. What's wrong with it? What could be so bad about it? That
they didn't elaborate.
There's nothing. Like, there's no additional information.
No, I guess they have a vendetta against the company.
It's probably the guy from Acme elbow braces is like, no, I want them to come buy an Acme elbow brace. It's the top of the line.
No, very, very short and sweet. It was just from Amazon customer: don't buy it. The end.
So you didn't listen to them.
So, well, no, I mean, you know, I need some reasons. Don't buy it. It's not enough.
Well, it's, when we were talking about the Amazon questions the other day about, like, will this cup work with water or lemonade or whatever? Somebody, a Kyle on Facebook, I think, said, you know, he said, that's a nice Deep Purple podcast mug. Will it work with coffee? that was a rare, it was only because we had just recorded that episode last week, or else I totally would have been like, why is he asking this?
Yeah.
But I happened to remember. But yeah, so the other night I was working a late shift on Thursday and then an early shift on Friday. So right Thursday before I had to go, I loaded the whole dishwasher up, put it in, and then boop, it's like, nope, we don't work anymore. That's not our thing. So I came the next after I, so I worked all night. Came home, slept, went right back to work, came home, and then started working on the dishwasher. And I was like, it looks like the motherboard's fried, and it's gonna be $250 to buy a new one. Even if I do it myself, I'm like, screw that. I'm just buying a new dishwasher. But the one that I want is out of stock. So we had so many dishes. And then we, of course, had a big family meal last night. And I literally spent all day today just doing dishes, letting them dry, doing dishes, letting them dry. And I'm finally caught all up, but my hands are torn up. So.
You didn't use palm olive?
Yeah, you're soaking in it. I was soaking in it, but it was not palm olive. So
yeah, he was soaking in it, folks.
I'm suffering with it now.
Mm.
But yeah, so it goes. So we're getting a new one delivered in 4 days. So hopefully we'll be in good shape when that thing comes in.
Oh, good.
Way more
you.
Money than we wanted to spend, but Jen's work reviewed the thing, and they got good, really good reviews. So hopefully this will be the last dishwasher we ever buy. Yeah, right.
And well, send me the reviews on that, because I want to write one that just says don't buy it and see what happens.
We'll see what happens. Okay, so hey, if you want to support our show, there's a number of ways you can do it. You can click on the support our show link in the show notes. You can leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. You can buy merch at our Etsy store, but you can also become a patron on Patreon or on PayPal for as little as $1 a month. You help support the show, keep us in good things, and all the money goes back into the show. We buy albums to review. We buy tickets to shows. We buy DVDs. We pay for our various memberships and things that we need to pay for to run the show. So any support you could give us would be greatly appreciated. We also can donate on Cash App at $DPPOD. And a new one, you can support us on Coffee. Have you ever seen that one? Coffee.
What's his name? Martin Popoff uses it. It says Coffee rhymes with no fee. That's how I know.
Oh, okay. No fee. Coffee then. There we go. I didn't know. I thought maybe it was coffee because the little icon is a coffee mug.
Maybe he's wrong. I don't know.
So we figure.
Yeah, who knows? I have no idea.
He knows more than we do about a lot of things, so we'll just assume that he's right. So Ko-fi. If somebody's on that platform, just trying to make it easier for anyone that wants to support our show. I was trying to sign up for it. I'm like, why can't I sign up for this? Oh, it says this email's already in use. I'm like, because I probably signed up for it like 3 years ago and then never set it up. So it's ready to go if you want to do it. And speaking of supporting the show, Hey-o!
Geez.
Patron.
Let me try that again. Hey-o!
You
got
a green bullfrog in your throat? What's going on? Our newest patron, Cynthia Doobie.
Thank
you so much, Cynthia. Come joining us at the $5 tier, the $5 money lender tier, I should say. And Cynthia, Cynthia's note is very interesting. I'm writing from beautiful West Warwick, Rhode Island.
Get out.
Imagine that. I grew up in Smithfield and Barreville. Still have some family in Smithfield. Doobie cousins and uncle. Blah, blah, blah. So I love your podcast, specifically episode 55 from 2020. After seeing the Dio documentary, I was looking for more Dio love and appreciation. That definitely came through with you guys. And when I realized you were from Rhode Island, I got even more excited. So imagine that. We've got a that's a big one. Our first Rhode Island patron. All right. Shout-outs to Rhode Island. Yeah, really excited about that one.
Cynthia, slide into my DMs. We'll get together.
Yeah, you guys go offer a Ko-fi.
Well, so hey, when you're visiting relatives, I'm like 5-10 minutes from Smithfield. Let's do something.
The funny thing is, my aunt was a Doobie by marriage. So I was like, am I related like by marriage to this new patron? That would be, of course, it's classic Rhode Island. We'd know each other. So we did a little family tree swap, and apparently we are. I mean, there might be some connection there, but we can't find it right away. So
tenuous as it may be, as you would say.
Tenuous as it may be, but my aunt was a Doobie. So.
Oh, yeah, that's funny. Later on, I'm going to smoke a Doobie.
And later on, you're going to hear a snippet from the Doobie Brothers. There's lots of Doobie references.
Mm.
They're good Doobies. She goes on to say, I've liked Purple Sabbath, Rainbow, Dio, etc. for as long as I can remember, but I never had much initiative in purchasing or collecting records, and I never dug too deeply into band histories, members, lineup changes, etc. I don't really know why. Then I went through a kind of personal dark ages in the late 80s, right through the 2000s, where I wasn't really listening to much music at all. And I missed out on so much from that time period. Seeing the Dio doc really lit the fire under my butt to seek out what I never did in the past, and now I have a lot to catch up on. I'm really grateful to have stumbled across your podcast, and I'm looking forward to learning more about Deep Purple and all of the great stuff around them. I'm psyched. I've been recommending you guys to some friends, and I gave a little shout out on Reddit as well, so I'm trying to get the word out. Nice. I'm even super late to the podcast thing, but that's just typical for me, I guess. Anyway, thank you for doing what you do. I'll be around in rock sin. So thank you so much, Cynthia. But How amazing is that, right? Like, somebody just stumbled on the show and is like, boom, like, is so sold on our nonsense that they're immediately signing up. It wasn't even like, oh, I'm going to give it a chance. Like, I heard one episode and I'm like, boom, I'm in. Like, I heard, I'm sure she's referring to our Dio episode. So hopefully the rest of our episodes live up to that hype we set 3 years ago whenever we did that.
We got some good ones here and there.
Yeah, every so often we stumble onto something good. So yeah, so thank you very much, Cynthia. Looking forward to your support, and have fun listening. You got a huge back catalog to catch up on. So thanks,
Cynthia,
to some of our other
call
Patreons.
Me.
Call John. Hang out with John. You can hang out with John and Rich and all the Rhode Island, New England crew. Our executive level patrons coming in at the $25 Uncommon Man tier, we have Ovis Nokvian Purple Maniac. At the £10 tier, Dr. Jill Brees. At the turn it up to $11 tier, Clay Wambacher, Frank Thielgard Mortensen, Alan Ain't Too Proud to Beg, and Mikkel Steen. And at the $10 Someone Came tier, Ryan M., Jeff Bryce, Victor Campos, Better Call Saul Evans. Thank you to all of you for your generous support of the Deep Purple podcast. And with that, it's time to get into something, and that is, of course, Postcards from the Edge of Connecticut. And this week's Postcards from the Edge of Connecticut doesn't come from Connecticut at all. It comes from Florida. Oh, look at that guy. Fierce. Look at the chompers on that alligator there.
Oof. Look at those chompers.
The quintessential Florida postcard with a giant chomping alligator on it. says, Nate, now there are some choppers for you. Greetings from Fort Lauderdale. Sunny and mid-70s, low 20s. Pete. So the Gardeau has been traveling around all around Florida and sent us this wonderful postcard. And for those of you that don't know, it's a live episode. We're making it a live stream, and the Gardeau is actually on the stream right now. So thank you for joining us, Gardeau. We appreciate it. A last-minute stream. But is that all we have, John?
No, we have another one. Postcards from the Edge of Fort Lauderdale. So here's mine. This one, I don't know if you could see it. It says you, and there's like a bunch of people wailing and gnashing their teeth in snow. And then on the other side, me, and then it's a tropical paradise. Thanks a lot.
That's accurate.
That's a more amusing one. The alligator one is definitely more a classic Florida. But my message is, yo, John, stay away from that Moutiz fella here in Lauderdale. Keep warm, Peter. Now the funny thing is that I want to point out is that whether it was in our text group or on this, he always spells Moutiz differently.
Yeah, I think it's a bit. At first, I thought maybe he was getting it wrong, but he's too consistent with how he changes the spelling up that it has to be on purpose.
Well, I went ahead and I like phonetically sounded out like the three ways that I've seen that he's misspelled them. And so here they are. There's Matuz.
Yeah.
Moots. And Moutuz.
Moutuz.
But you know what? That bastard doesn't deserve to have his name pronounced correctly anyway. So thank you, Gardeau.
Yeah, that's right. And didn't he change his name to like Kevin or something so he could try to avoid the bad reviews on Airbnb?
I think it was Alexander.
Alexander, that's right.
Kevin.
Something like that.
Anything else interesting in the mail or?
Not, now that you're saying that, I feel like I should have gotten something else in the mail. Not yet, I don't think.
Okay.
Did you?
Just wondering. I'm sorry.
There's two Gardeaus in the chat now. Wait, the other one just disappeared.
Pete's glamour shot popping up, his headshot.
Why am I supposed to have gotten something else in the mail?
No, I don't know.
No. Okay. Well. Oh boy!
Maybe by next week.
Okay.
Hey, here's Rich.
Yeah, I don't think I do have actually something else in the mail, but it's not really. I don't think it's what you're talking about. On a more sad note, before we get into the body of the show, and this is a second parter. So the first part, We did episode 195. We did the first part of this concert that we're about to hear the second part of now. So if you haven't heard that, you want to go back, do it. This is kind of a two-parter sandwich. We had a two-parter with a two-parter in between. So we did part one of this, then we did a two-parter on Rainbow Stranger and Us All, and now we're doing the second part of this episode. So it's a little uncharacteristic, but sometimes the way that our schedule works, things just get a little wacky like that. So, but you can listen to them in any order you want. And as our new patron Cynthia probably knows, and she's going back and looking at old episodes, most of them are evergreen, although we might bring up some current event stuff that although I can imagine if you're going back, you know, if you're hearing about Mooties for the first time and confused, when you go back and hit that episode, eventually it'll make sense. Okay, so on a sad note, some of you who have been listening for a long time probably know this name, but a patron of ours, Gerald Kelly, passed away. And, you know, he was a patron for a long time. Really, really great guy, really nice guy. And we had developed sort of a kind of a correspondence for a while. And he would actually just, he would go through Kerrang magazines and just send me these big drops in email, like, oh, yeah, just stuff I found about Rainbow or Dio or whatever it is. And he'd send me all these great little clippings and scans from, Kerrang. And we, you know, we'd go back and forth, and it was just a really nice relationship. And, somewhat recently I was going through some of his old emails, actually digging up some stuff for shows, and I actually just will search my email and see if I can find anything from him, and I hadn't heard from him in a little bit, so I sent him an email back saying, oh, hey, you know, I just stumbled on this email and it was really helpful in the show and hope all is well. And I didn't hear anything back from him, and I kind of got a little worried, like, oh, well, that's kind of unusual because we were going back and forth. He said he was going to be retiring and all this, so I thought, oh, maybe he's just busy or whatever, but I didn't hear anything back, and I kind of feared the worst. So I started, like, just kind of doing some internet detective work, and unfortunately stumbled upon the fact that he had passed away, and I found so I'll put a little something in the show notes with his little with his obituary and stuff about him. So he was the 24th patron of the show. We have to sign up. He did a lot of help behind the scenes, and he'll be really missed. So you know what, I had his address because he had actually ordered a t-shirt a while back. So I just as a Hail Mary, I wrote a nice little Christmas card and sent it. I think it was right before Christmas, or maybe right after Christmas, and sent it to the house and said, hey, if there's any family that's getting this, you know, just wanted to let you know that we're thinking. And just the other day, I got in a letter from his family, and it's a really nice little card here. It's really cool. It's like all little cutouts. I don't know if they made it themselves. It says music heals the soul. It's nice. Got all these little stuff kind of all glued together. And on the inside is a really nice note. Here it is. It's actually really cool. It says the Kelly family, and there's the Deep Purple logo in there. Pretty cool.
Nice.
It says, Nate and John, we received your note. The entire Kelly family was touched by your kind words about Jerry. Jerry did love music. We knew he followed Beatles podcast, but we were unaware of the Deep Purple podcast. All of Jerry's siblings, three remain, learned to appreciate music due to his being such a music enthusiast. It is nice to know Jerry will be remembered and missed by your community. And then a little quote says, where words fail, music speaks. Hans Christian Andersen. And then they put in a little cutout here that's a little poem that says, perhaps you send a lovely card or sat in a quiet chair. Perhaps you send a flower piece. If so, we saw it there. Perhaps you spoke the kindest words, as any friend could say. Perhaps you were not there at all. Just thought of us that day. Whatever you did to console our hearts, we thank you so much, whatever the part. So I was very touched by this nice note from Jerry's family, and that's a name that, you know, will live on. I'll miss saying Jerry's name in the patron shout outs, just much love to Jerry's family, and we're thinking about him. Oh, that's a good idea. Rich said we should rename the patron tier after him. We should, if I can remember what patron tier he was in. Yes, we'll call it, we will call it the Gerald Kelly or Memorial Tier or whatever. We'll come up with something. Actually, his email address, interestingly, was he you know, like you can make your little name show up. However, his was Mean Mr. Mole. And I always thought that was funny because I didn't know if it was like a combination of Mean Mr. Mustard and Old Blind Mole or what it even came from.
But that's what it sounds like. Yeah.
Or is it maybe from the Yellow Submarine movie? He was a big Beatles fan, so it was really nice of him to support our show, and we'll be greatly missing him. So. That aside, I think we're ready to get into the meat of the episode after those sad words from a former patron. But as we left off last time in reviewing this album, I believe we had just finished Anyone's Daughter. I think that's the last track
yes.
we... Yes,
I believe
you remember,
so, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, because that was kind of when they brought it down. And then that was kind yes. of like seemed like the bridge between the first and second half of the show, which was I just remembered as being the perfect time for it to kind of be that ending point for the first parter of the episode.
Good. Okay. I wasn't 100% sure on that one, so I'm glad to know that you actually remember, because I don't.
Yeah, and I don't remember shit. So you know, it's.
No, I'm like, if you remember, then it must be sure. It must be for sure.
Yeah, and yeah, it's just it stuck in my head for some reason.
All right, then. So luckily, this file I have is kind of chaptered up, so we can, I think it's trying to see where it is here. Trying to see if I'm in the right spot. But I remember it was about the halfway mark that happened. So let's see here. Probably should have queued this up ahead of time. I think this is it. So we're going to play this. Yeah, this is it. So here we go. We're kicking right into. I think John's gonna lead us right into. Two. Oh, somebody's got the lighter. And while we do this, I have my. Tiny little beer. It's called Little Buddy. I got for Christmas. So it's interesting. Anya was such a, you know, that a cobbled together song on The Battle Rages On that they just kind of made a new improvised beginning for it. And they did that with mm-hmm. Ritchie too, because they couldn't really do what they had done in the studio. I don't know if Ritchie ever played an acoustic guitar on the on any live shows with Deep Purple.
I haven't seen a lot of live Satriani, but I didn't know that was his thing. Is like when he plays, he kind of shrugs his shoulders up and like hunches over when
yeah,
he plays.
Yeah.
It's like his stance.
Yeah, he's got that like he's got a very interesting stance. Fielding is offering his tier as the Mean Mr. Mole tier. which is a generous offer. Oh, Roger Glover just came out from in between the amps. He was like hiding back there. It's kind of a narrow little entryway too. What was the show we talked about where they had like Gillan was naked backstage and the backstage was right on the stage and he was naked and they like shoved him out on stage naked and he just didn't care at all, he just bowed and stuff.
I do remember you saying that. I can't remember the show.
I can't remember the context.
Oh, Gillan looks like he just took a shower or something.
Yeah, maybe he was backstage with Roger. They were showering up for the second half. So as we get into the rest of my Christmas candy, as I move through it, the most recent one is sausage herring. They're little licorice herring. Not real herring.
Okay.
They're vegan. See, it says vegan up there in case you think it's going to be real fish.
Oh, okay. All right, good. I was going to be like, your candy is getting more interesting by the week here. What's going on with the picture here?
Yeah, I messed it up. Sorry.
No. There we go.
Can you see it now?
Yep.
Okay. A little fishy here. Oh man, that's good. Picking right up where I left off and wondering if that is a like transparent guitar or not. I just can't tell. Shiny as hell, whatever it is.
I know Gillan is blocking it, so I can't tell.
Hey, get out of the way, man. Can't you tell there's some guy over there filming? Oh, there he goes.
I think it might be black.
Maybe. He's throwing in some Ritchie Arabic style scales there.
He seems to be playing pretty true to that style. Like if you just listened for a minute, you'd think it was Ritchie playing it.
Yeah. Bends give it away a little, but that scale was really Ritchie-esque. I think Ritchie would enjoy the solo. He probably does enjoy it because he didn't have to play it or be in the band. Oh, God, he's good.
Wow.
Full Satriani mode. Extended track here, so I'm assuming we're getting a lengthy solo here.
All right, that gives it away that it's Satriani.
Yeah, we're well out of Blackmore territory now. Scott in the chat says, I wonder how long it took the audio engineer to erase all the Ritchie shouts from the crowd. It doesn't sound like Satriani or Morse had to deal with too much of that, as opposed to, you know, what Tommy had to deal with or what other bands would heckle people about.
Mm-hmm.
well, look at the flashes on Pace's kick drum as he's hitting it. It's expanding the drum and it's reflecting the light.
Well, they're really doing a lot with this track.
Awesome.
Yeah, great, really, really good. Yeah, really good track for extending out and jamming on.
Whoa.
Yeah. That was the worst pan I've ever seen in my life.
That pan was as smooth as silk.
The guy was like, put his foot up and just like kicked the camera. Like,
how many times do you think I have to kick it to get over to yelling? 1, 2, 3. There we go. We got him. Oh wait, like one too many. I'll kick the other way.
He's leaning back and he's got his feet up and he's just kind of like.
Scott said this is a bootleg, right? I guess
professional
bootleg.
Professional job all the way. Total pro.
I think they needed maybe a little WD-40 for that tripod. At least it's not jerking up and down. It's just when they pan from one member to the other, it's not seamless.
Seamless is not a word I would use. That was great. Pace is like,
Pace is like, yeah, taking a deep breath. Well, this is only like 3 weeks after for you listening. This is 2 months later that we're watching this. I hope we're not repeating ourselves too much.
I was thinking the same thing that Gardeau was. Don't wipe off that wig, Pacey.
He said it's a French call. This song is called The Battle Rages On.
Oh, classic Gillan.
This is such a great riff. But I think we talked extensively about Roger's bass in the last episode, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, with the whammy bar.
That was. It's a beauty, though. Gardeau says, "Is that better than did you ever have sex?"
Yeah.
I think that's the thing about Gillan's stage banter is quirky and zany. JLT's is a little cringeworthy.
Yeah, I was gonna say, JLT's is cringy. Yeah. You know, what did he say? My
Czechoslovakian is a little rusty.
My Czechoslovakian is not so good. So, have any of you ever had sex? We're going to be, like, talking about that for, like, forever. It's never going to get old.
It's one of the greatest lines that's ever been said at a concert.
I know you said it before in the shows with Ritchie, but this Battle Rages On stuff is definitely way better live.
I mean, there's a lot of great material, not about
like many of these songs on the album, but like Anya and this one, like fantastic. I mean, you're right. What a great riff.
Yeah, I mean, this is, I think, by far my favorite song on the album, but it's great material on the album. I feel like we're just struggling through a few late 80s, early 90s to mid 90s albums that are just, the production is a little lacking.
Yeah,
Rich points out a good one that Gillan has the greatest stage line ever for Made in Japan. You know, make everything louder than everything else.
Yeah, classic line. Gillan sounds very good this particular night.
Yeah, fantastic. Satriani has been mostly his own guy through his entire career. It's still so interesting to me to see this one little brief snapshot in time where he's playing a part like this, you know?
Yeah.
He's not just being the guy in charge. He's being a player in a great band and knows, and even though he's been the leader of his own destiny and band and albums for his entire career, he knows exactly how to just slide it and do exactly what he's supposed to do. He's not grabbing for the spotlight. He's not doing anything crazy. He's just playing really great.
I don't know. I think we mentioned that before, is I never saw him for that kind of player.
No.
I mean, even though like him, Steve Vai, a couple of other guitar players like that, they're different than a guitar player like say Yngwie, who wants the spotlight and wants control all the time. Whereas like him and Steve Vai in particular, Satriani and Steve Vai are very similar in style, had like pretty successful solo careers, could definitely be the leader of their own bands, but they've successfully kind of gone into band situations and played for the band and for the songs, and I think that that's really cool that they don't have an ego about it, because they know they can do both. I feel like a guy like him is so talented, he knows he could do anything. And for this, it must have been a combo of just not being able to pass up playing with these guys and having fun, and probably a pretty good payday too.
Oh yeah, I'm sure he did okay for himself.
Paice's delicately wiping everything down there.
He is very, now that you mentioned, he's very careful about how he's patting that thing on his head.
Because you remember Denmark 72, he ran that towel through his hair, like, yeah. Not anymore.
And I'm sure you're going to be sweating a lot. I'm wearing a wig under those lights. Oh my God, it's going to be brutal. Sounds almost like David Gilmour.
Like who?
David Gilmour.
Oh. That's just a David Coverdale. I'm like, the hell is he talking about?
Just how that's seeming flat. Oh, the lighters are back out. I like the Gardeau in one of their recent episodes was talking about how he still brings the lighter to the concert and he uses it to like test thermal couplers at work or something. I just love the idea of just having a lighter you carry around strictly for concert purposes. It's also been mentioned in the chat that there's a JLT video on YouTube where he was live talking about masturbation on stage, so...
That horny bastard.
He just has no filter. It's like, maybe you don't need to mention that. Richie's out of the band, so you know what happens the second anybody leaves. The blind man cries. It's busted out. I'm surprised they didn't do like the first show with Tommy Bolin. They should have busted it out.
Yeah, when a blind man cries, as soon as Richie's gone, dust it off.
Hear how Coverdale and Hughes handle that one. He's like, when a blind man cries, he can't see those big tits. Oh, Coverdale, why? Hughes, he's a blind man. This is great. I know this isn't your favorite Deep Purple song.
Well, I mean, the live versions have been growing on me.
One day. I really don't know what... I mean, maybe Richie's just in your camp. He just wasn't sold on it.
Well, I mean, you know, let's not go crazy here. We're not talking about trying to sell me on a Warhorse album or something. This guy can be turned around.
Place in line.
Yeah, exactly. I can be turned around. Well, they would have to do a killer version of Place in Line to turn me around.
Oh yeah, you haven't heard it till you heard it live, John. Great blues playing from Satcher. For not being on the album. He must be, because he never wanted to play it live.
Mm-hmm.
He just didn't win with Hold On, I guess.
Nope.
He wanted to relegate that one probably to a B-side of something that never would be seen. Being like a kind of a precursor to Mistreated in the typical Richie vein of trying to one-up. I mean, it doesn't have that like riff and everything, but it's that same like bluesy heavy dynamic song.
Yeah, but listen to that friggin' solo in this right now is really good. And he's playing with a lot of feeling here.
And that's the kind of criticism that'll be levied at people like Satriani a lot is, oh, they don't have any feeling. They just play notes really fast.
Well,
maybe that's just the kind of music that they like and they like to make. Is that sounds like it to you, but you can't listen to this and say, yeah, this guy's got no feeling. This is completely sterile and emotionless.
I mean, there are a lot of guitar players that play in that style that if you lump them all in together, if you're not into this type of music, you could say that. But I think that him and Vi are two of the most like passionate and emotional players of this style of guitar. I mean, look at what he just did here.
Right.
Wow.
I think those players can achieve this level. They just are into kind of a different style of music.
Well, yeah, exactly.
Well, I feel like, wow, I'm done this beer already? It's like, well, it's, you know, it's a tiny, a tiny.
It'd be like a sip.
It's like a little can of tomato sauce you get at the store. Song into another. The lights are shining on Paice and he has a big smile and he's like, hey! Paice looks kind of like Herod from Jesus Christ Superstar. Just get up. Start doing the little...
Nice. The lights up on Paice.
There's something about the angle that he's being filmed at that Paice just looks hilarious.
It's like he fades in, he's like this.
And he's got a big old smile.
Well, he's probably having a great old time.
And then when they hit the hit, he goes into the darkness and then they light him up again. There he's into the blackness now. He's only lit up when he's playing. Ah, there he is, he's back. It's kind of funny, like, how many times they've done this over the years, and it's just, I mean, obviously, they always make it different, but it's like they start up the, they start it up different all the time, but they all know what they're, like, they rehearse a different intro for it every time.
Yeah.
Oh, there we go. We're back over to John Lord.
That was.
Well, maybe the camera just weighs like 600 pounds.
Maybe.
He's like using his like elbow. He's like his shouldering into it. It was over.
When the camera. The way the camera was moving, the way you vocalized the sound effects you made were the perfect like audio for what the camera's doing visually. Oh, there's the bongos.
Somebody singing along. Is someone in the crowd singing along? You hear it? Man, they're going nuts with the harmonica. That is the harmonica player for Deep Purple right there. Something we mentioned pre-show. If you search on Google for Deep Purple, it lists in the little sidebar, it says Ritchie Blackmore, guitar, Ian Gillan, harmonica, David Coverdale, lead vocals. And we're trying to imagine what that mark would sound like, where Gillan is only the harmonica player. He's like the dancer in the Mighty Boston's. Just comes and plays harmonica for like the one song Deep Purple has harmonica in.
Yeah, Rich, congas, bongos, whatever.
Yeah, they are. I didn't want to call you out on the congas thing, but then I forgot Rich was in the chat, so.
I don't know, whatever.
And then I didn't need to.
This guy said steel drums.
Oh, listen to that.
Lazy man.
Yeah, me so airey. Me so lazy.
The Rastafarian version of lazy.
Maybe I got it from when he was playing pool with Bob Marley, bro.
Well, I'm lazy.
Yeah, here goes Paice.
Oof.
I'm glad the guy in the audience doesn't know the words to more of the songs, because that would have been getting really annoying. I love how he does that. He gets like out of his seat. He's like, he's out of his seat. Look at him. Look at how high up his elbows are. The chat's going off the rails. Fielding saying that they used steel drums that time John Stamos sat in and they covered Kokomo.
Deep Stamos.
I like the Stamos era of Purple the best. when you're constructing like your ideal Deep Purple lineup, you gotta have John Stamos and Randy California.
And Ian Gillan on harmonica.
On harmonica, yeah. It's like a 9-piece band. Putting Ian Gillan on just the harmonica for the, you know, how many songs in their entire catalog have harmonica? Like 3? With only one that they ever play live. It'd be like putting Paice on, like, the tambourine. Here we go. Oh. He just jumped ahead a little bit there. I don't know if the video went cut out for a second. Oh, now he's dead. Now they're playing Satch Boogie.
Oh yeah. Oh wow.
So I don't know if there was a gap or if they just went right into it, but the video seemed like it cut out for a second.
That's pretty cool though. It does fit in. The kind of the tempo of Lazy.
Thank you.
Wow, what a unique thing to have seen. In Deep Purple Mark II backing up Satriani playing one of his solo songs.
Yeah, I know, right?
Essentially.
And when you bought these tickets, you probably thought you were going to be seeing Ritchie Blackmore, like standard Mark II lineup. Not that that would have been a bad thing by any stretch, but now you're getting this weird, like you said, unique experience.
So what year was this again?
94. So I believe it was June.
Yeah.
So, you know, Ritchie would have been out of the band for like 7 months at this point. So, you know, possible people would have bought their tickets later, but I don't know when they went on sale for the tour. Sound like Ozzy when he said that. Sounds like he's wrapping up, but we got a ways to go.
Yeah. Huh?
Spin-off chat about Full House going on. And we'll just leave. We'll leave. That's just. That's the kind of things you can help for as a patron of the show. You get to be in the chat talking about Full House. Oh wow, Fielding open for Dave Coulier. Okay, we'll have to stay focused. Stay focused.
I am one of the few that knows nothing about Full House. Didn't watch it, didn't care.
You never watched it when it came out?
No. Nope.
I was never a fan either. I just never... The only words that the guy to the side of the camera seems to know is the word space truck, and so we should be fairly safe with this one. Gillan's like, you just see Gillan wandering behind the stage with his microphone. It was Stan, so he must be done for a little bit. Oh, snap. Apparently not. He's gonna have to run back. Oh, there he goes. He just ran back out. He's like, oh, they surprised me.
Yeah. The guy, I can't even do it because he's like singing so just like blandly off to the side. You know, this era where John Lord was pulling his hair back in the gray ponytail, when he was still kind of like in between styles before he started wearing like the suits and everything and dressing more like gentlemanly, he kind of looked like a bouncer. This is just this big guy. He's wearing a big black t-shirt. He's got that big walrus mustache.
It'd be great if he was wearing a black shirt with a black tie. You could picture him standing outside a Mediterraneo like on a Saturday night.
There's a black t-shirt and he turns around and just says security on it.
Sometimes you do it over the music, but I don't think this is going to be an extended Mark IV instrumental. Mm-hmm. So we'll maybe have to just pause it before the encore to do the patrons. Unless they go off the rails with some sort of avant-garde instrumental. Done Painted Black recently or in something else we covered recently?
Yeah, I believe so.
I can't remember what it was.
Like when he does that. That's a move.
Size of those Leslies behind them.
Yeah, big ass speakers.
Probably not a good idea to hand him one of those. It's a meat grinder.
Yeah,
How the job boy gets excited and starts pointing.
I love it when they do a little callback to Mark One.
Yeah, it's so good. That was tight ending. That was a Mark One callback in the way that he's abusing that guitar. The only thing he didn't do is put the pick in his mouth and just curly slap it. Having a little conference with him. All right, he's about to say something, so I'm going to pause it here so we can call out our next round of patrons, and then we'll end with, of course, our final patrons. But coming in at the core level, at the $7.77 Keep It Warm Rat tier, we have Michael Vader and Richard Fusey. At the $6.99, the new nice price tier, Mr. Fielding Fowler. At the episode $6.66 tier, Steve Coldwell, Arthur Smith, and Anton Glaving. And at the $6.65 almost evil tier, Kenny Wymore. At the $5.99 the nice price tier, Robert Smith, Peter from Illinois, Michael Bagford, and Carl Hellberg. And at the 60 Swedish kroner tier, we have got Zwapper, the Electric Alchemist. And at the $5 now called the Mean Mr. Mole tier, we have John Convery, German Heidel, Adrian Hernandez, Jesper Ellman, Oleksi the Perfect Stranger, Slepikoff, James North, Mark Hodgetts, Will Porter, Kev Roberts, Percival Frequency, Scott Zerns, and heyo, our newest patron, Cynthia Doobie, all coming in at the Mean Mr. Mole honorary in honor of Gerald Kelly tier. So thank you so much to all of you for your generous support of the show. And now, back to your show. Let's hear what Gillan's about to say.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Show you are fantastic. I tell you, we've had a great night tonight. Just super. Thank you for being here. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Some cool delay there. But I gotta say, there's something without Blackmore in the band. You're pretty sure you're going to get an uncle. When Blackmore's doing, you just never know. It could be a four-piece encore. It could be no encore.
Nah. You can make us laugh.
I love the side convo going on here.
Which one? The German one or the one in the chat where they're talking about Pacey's pants?
No, the...
Purple, yeah. Pacey pants. Cardo is called.
Talking about the video, I don't know what's going on in the chat here, but
some German chatter. Based on where these chapter markers are, they should be back on stage almost any second now. You see the purple Pacey pants ride again. Oh. Oh, he's he is wearing some real purple pants, isn't he? Are they jeans, or did he borrow some, like, of Gillan's pajama pants? Oh, Glover's got the traditional Rickenbacker encore bass back out.
We know what this is going to be.
You can be reasonably certain. And will it be the only song they play? Do they play others? Who knows? Who that doesn't have access to setlist.fm knows? Chat is pointing out that Hush has been played 1,491 times live.
I can believe that.
Gardo is calling the purple sabotage pants. I don't know if he means that that's his version of the Bill Ward sabotage pants. but I don't think it even holds a candle because they're a little looser.
Yeah, I mean, I really think that like any just tight one colored stretch looking pants could be considered sabotage pants.
Yeah, they don't look too tight though. This was like the early 90s, so you know they're not too tight.
Actually, I'm wearing my sabotage pants now.
The ones that you wore?
Yes, I just looked down. I'm like, hey, these are my sabotage. Yeah, they're my pajama pants. Well, I mean, you didn't make it clear if it was when I was over your house, if it was casual or not. So I just walked around in my pajamas.
It was casual. No, I run a strictly formal household with three children.
Yeah, sorry, I didn't dress up in my three-piece suit for the episodes.
Fielding in the chat is asking if Ian Gillan has ever done any other lineup songs other than Hush. I don't believe so. Mandrake Group, yeah.
No, actually, in the early days, I think he did.
He also did Bring That Neck.
Right? Yeah.
I mean, yeah, he had to have in the early days, right?
I mean, when they were transitioning over from really, really early, right from Mark 1 to Mark 2, like, I can't remember, but I think that's...
When they didn't have any songs of their own yet, right?
Yeah, these guys are right, yeah.
I wonder, when is the latest that Gillan ever did a Mark 1 song other than Hush? It probably was 1969. Like, I can't imagine much, maybe early 1970, but after that, I think they would have been... And they really didn't do Hush, really, right? Until they brought it back in, like, the 80s. I don't think they ever did Hush. Maybe Scott can pull up the list of, where it shows you the dates. There's probably a big void between, like, 1969 and 1984 where they didn't do Hush. I'd guess. Oh, I did Hush at the concerto. There you go. But yeah, they'd been in the band for about 3 months at that point, so... Between 1969 and 1984, I wonder if they ever did it. Nice tight in there. So, Gardo, get ready for it. I think somebody in the crowd's going to get their wish.
Imagine you're in church. Actually, that's what this song is all about, originally. It's got a weird, freaky church-type intro. It's originally called Kneel and Pray, this song. But we changed it to something else.
Did you just reference Ritchie? He said Ritchie called this Kneel and Pray. Is that what he said?
I think which we called Kneel.
Oh, I thought he said Ritchie wanted to call it Kneel and Pray.
Well, it was called Kneel and Pray. Saying that it was a song about church, but I believe the Kneel and Pray was not really about church.
I don't think Coverdale ever did Hush.
I That'd be awesome if Roger busted out the Rickenbacker recently. You can even do it for retro purposes anymore, I don't think. Every year on my Christmas list for my family, I put that exact model of Rickenbacker that he's holding right there. So far, nobody's bought it for me.
Santa hasn't brought it.
I think people tend to skim past the like $1,800 gifts and look for something a little more affordable. But I think, hey, you gotta shoot your shot. You never know. One of these days, it'll show up under the tree.
True. Hell yeah. This is what Deep Purple's been missing. That back and forth.
Yeah, except I'm going to pass out. I'm going to get dizzy and I'm going to need to lie down. This camera keeps going back and forth between them.
Well, I mean the back and forth between...
Yes.
Keyboard and guitar, not the friggin' stupid camera work.
The cameraman just gave up and he's just keeping it on Lord.
Oh God, if he had to pan back and forth between the two of them, he would have, like, his... Friggin' arm would have fallen off.
It's too heavy. I can't do it.
You just hear from behind the camera.
Now Rich is claiming I don't know how to pronounce Rickenbacker. What is it, Rickenbacker? And also, I'm pretty sure if I show up with cash in my hand, they're not going to ask me to pronounce it, Rich. But thank you for your input.
No, I think it's called the Steinbrenner.
Peter said at the same time.
Gardeau's on my tip. He knows what I'm thinking.
I like the one where... Who was it that made... Was it Rich that made the thing that, in, you know, the Steinbrenner doesn't have a head? So, like, he put his George Steinbrenner head with it. This is great that they busted out Speed King. Oh, here, we'll see if he's gonna do it, John. It's gonna be a tough one.
No, he's...
Nah.
No, but you know, the headbanging made up for it. It's fine.
Yeah, it was good headbanging.
Nice.
Wait, there's more? Oh my goodness.
I didn't think they were gonna play it.
Everyone's going crazy. People play it.
Gillan and Satriani clearly saw somebody that they
just
know.
Saw his cousin in the audience. Hey, it's my German cousin.
Hey.
It's my German cousin, Klaus Satriani.
Let's go out for schnitzel later. After the show. No, I think it was Sneezy Shaler.
Yeah, Rich Sneezy Shaler. I like that he unmuted so they could sneeze into the microphone.
I think that we had the reverse cough switch effect.
Yeah. He put it on just for when he was gonna sneeze. We'll have to. Sadly, you won't hear that on the audio podcast.
Oh, great. Now nobody's going to know what the hell we're talking about.
I think it'll still come through on... I think it'll still come through on... whatchamacallit? I think it'll still come through on the YouTube. So watch the YouTube to hear Rich sneezing in his microphone.
Oh, they went nuts for that last part. He stayed pretty true to the solo.
Yeah.
Which is nice.
Ricardo says Satch has steelo. He does. Can't hear the guy on the side of the camera. On the water.
Guy next to the camera's not singing it.
Maybe he's just blending in. Ricardo is questioning whether could actually hear them. some shush. Gillan's controlling the volume levels with his hands. He's trying to throw them off. Great closing.
Thank you. We love you. You're amazing.
brought you down just to bring you right back up.
Oof. All right, that's the most Satriani thing he's done all night.
It's all he's seen for the end. I'm going to, just to prove that I am Joe Satriani, I'm going to finger tap 128th notes to the riff of Smoke on the Water. Was winding up for a big stage dive or something. That's a great show. Like, I think the one of those early Japan shows is a really good bootleg audio wise of this. But as far as the quality of the show and the performance, this has got to be every bit as good. I mean, that's a really, really great show.
Excellent.
Very well done.
That was a great show.
Yeah, I mean, that's it. I think it's a really important thing to cover the Satriani era, as short as it was. It's funny though, as short as it was, they probably played live almost as long as they did with Tommy Bolin, longer actually than they did with Tommy Bolin. Really, really cool show, cool era. Yeah, Rich saying that they would love everyone always says they would love a official release of, you know, of good quality Satriani show, but
yeah,
with all the factors at hand, it's probably never going to happen. But that would be cool. I would certainly be excited for that.
Yeah, I'm sold. I'm sold on this lineup.
Yeah, it's a great lineup. I mean,
Thought much of it before we started listening to these to this show, so.
Just would have been awesome to see what they would have done if they would have put out an album or written together. I'm glad, obviously, that they had Steve Morse, and you know we'll be diving into that soon enough. But not that we've already done a bunch of more stuff on the show, but yeah, it's those what ifs are always really interesting to think about. So, all right. So before we wrap up, we have to do something, and that is, of course, to thank our foundation level patrons. Coming in at the $3 aromatic feed tier, we have Simon Ford. At the $3.33 halfway to evil tier, we have Raff Calf, Spike the Rock Cat, and Spike's Mom. At the $3 nobody's perfect tier, we have Peter Gardeau, Ian DeRosier, Mark Roback, Duncan Leesk, Stuart McCord, Flight of the Rat Bat Blue Light, Ivan Fjeldbu, and Runar Simonsen. And then coming in at that tier, we also have JJ Snard, Ruinous Inadequacies, and Mike Catan. At the $1.71, I want my own tier, we have Rich Ingve Schaler. At the 10 kroner tier, we have Karsten Lau. And at the $1 made up name tier, we have The Liquid Oozes On, Leaky Mausoleum, Stephen Somerville, Concerto 1999 Fanatic, Hank the Tank, Private Eyes, Ashen Lionel,
Blackmore Tights,
and John Maselli.
Let the seats
Oh, five on the floor. Hey, you miss him. The clock works.
All right. Thank
he
you.
He always sounds so like sensual. He's always so like so horny whenever
I know,
he's
whether
like.
Whether it's a mop or a car. But thank you to all of those great patrons. Unfortunately, this was my absolutely most flawless production on the thing, but unfortunately, none of you got to hear it in the chat. But you'll hear it on the final episode because I did it perfectly. I just forgot to the audio wasn't shared until partway through. So,
oh, Nate.
So sorry to all you folks on the video feed that didn't catch some of those jingles and just saw awkward silence as I waited to say the next name.
You were like, well, you were announcing everybody, and you're like.
waiting
and so, we're all like what
yeah so yeah I think if there's ever any reason why you should be listening to the audio feed, that's just yet another reason, folks. If you're watching on YouTube, I hope you enjoy it, but the audio feed, oh, it's such a better experience audio wise everything, all of these plugins I got going on, all this post-production. You're just getting the raw good. But some people like that. Some people like that raw feel of the video. So, hey, good for you guys. All right. Well, that's it. That's our kind of close to the Satriani era. Not that we'll never visit or talk about Satriani in purple again, but thought it was worth doing a full show to kind of highlight that lineup. So... I don't know. Anything else before we wrap up? Oh, one thing we got to do. I meant to mention it at the top of the show, but forgot to mention it. And time is coming in, but we are going to be at Deep Purple in very soon. They're playing two shows that we will be at. And the first one is on John's birthday. Once again.
Oh, I hit the microphone. I was so excited. I'm like, woo. Hey, pull out that air horn.
Yeah, sorry. On John's birthday,
we are going to be... This is becoming a birthday tradition, going to see Deep Purple.
In Bensalem, Pennsylvania, right outside Philly, at the Excite Center at Parks Casino on February 10th for John's birthday. Our second birthday in a row going to see Deep Purple. Just kind of works out that way. And then the next night... in New Brunswick, New Jersey, at the State Theater, we'll be seeing them once again. So very exciting. Flying out there in a couple weeks to go, a few weeks, I should say, to go see the band once again. Very excited. We'll have a report for you on the show. Yeah. So we'll probably try to mention that at the top of the next show so we can kind of let everybody know. If there's anybody going to the show and want to meet up, keep in touch on whatever, Patreon, email, Twitter, however you want to contact us, and we'll try to meet up
and as,
or tell you where we're going to be having drinks before the show.
And as Rich mentioned in the chat here, if anybody wants to see the famous pre-birthday Kermit dance that I do when I drink too much,
oh boy.
Find out where we're having some drinks and come on down.
If you want to see John passed out in the cafeteria of yet another casino, if you're not able to make it, we will take pictures again and post them.
Good times.
Yes. All right. Well, with that, thank you to everybody in the chat that came on such short notice to listen along live, and we'll be right back at you next week with another fresh non-live streamed episode. So
yeah,
we'll see you then. All right, later everybody.
See ya.
Thank you for listening to the Deep Purple podcast. If you like what you hear and would like more episodes in the future, please donate on Patreon to support the show. You can also leave us a review in Apple Podcasts to help new people discover the show. You can follow us on YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for show updates. See deeppurplepodcast.com for more details. Thank you for listening.